Hey guys, happy Monday. I wanted to show you a few images of mine that have become sort of emblematic of my work over the years, and I wanted to take you behind the scenes in Photoshop so that we can sort of break them down a little bit and see what these images were like when they started. So the before pictures, how they were built in Photoshop, and then what they ended up being. We're going to jump into Photoshop today, and I chose these three images for a few reasons. One, because they really are a good example of what my work is like and what my workflow is like. And the other reason is that they each have a little something interesting about how they were made. For example, one of them, I had to expand the frame quite a lot to get the image. For another one, I had to drastically change the color of a dress from white to red. And in another, again, I had to play with surrealism to be able to get this weird, creepy effect. So I want to show you these three images, and let's just break them down and see what the thought process was behind them. I'm going to be showing you this image of the girl in this mansion chateau in France. This image of this creepy stuffing coming out of the back, and this image at the puddle. So we're going to start with perhaps the least disturbing of the images. And this image is called House of Solitude. I photographed this particular picture on a retreat that I was hosting in France. And I actually didn't have this planned. I had gone through my demonstrations of images, and then I thought, I need to do something else. I just need one more image to create with the group, and this was what I came up with. I had noticed that so many people in this big group of about 15 photographers were going to the most intricate locations in that chateau. I wanted to challenge myself to shoot in the least intricate space in that chateau with no props and no wardrobe. So I actually went into the bedroom next door and I got a bed sheet, a white bed sheet that I pulled off of the bed. I wrapped the model in it. This is model Jen Brooke. And I got a stool for her to stand on and we created this picture together. So let's dive in to see exactly what this was like while I was making it. If I go down to the bottom, you can see that I'm turning off all of the layers except for the first one that I started with. And this was my initial frame. So what you see right here, going all around, that was what I started with. And there were two reasons why I shot it this way. One is that I couldn't get back any further in the space. That was the amount of room that I had to shoot that particular angle. And the other reason was that if I start expanding my frame, meaning that I'm adding pixels to my pictures, I can print a lot larger too, which is really good for business. So I expanded my frame outward, and now I'll show you how I started putting it together. I started with my subject, and she was not naturally this high in the frame when I first put her in this space. So she was down a little bit lower. I had her on a stool, and I had my camera at an angle that was low enough that it looked like she was up higher when I eventually placed her into this frame. So I shot her from a lower angle so that she could look up higher. I placed her in, and then I started to expand the frame. And so that's what you see here. And you'll notice there's a bit of warping happening, and that's because these images didn't naturally fit together. So when I was putting this image on, it didn't just sit perfectly in place because I had this thing called parallax shift, where the lines in the image are going wonky and they weren't matching up. So I had to use the warp tool to match them up. And so these images here are just all of those extra pictures that I took all around the space being added in. Now this is the bottom of her dress, or what was actually a bed sheet. And while we were shooting, I went over and I swirled the bed sheet all around and got extra pictures of the bed sheet. And then these are some adjustments to make it look believable. So here we've got the final shape. I got rid of this little tiny, you can see that there, this little piece that was sticking out behind there. Blended the sheet a little bit more. And now we start to get into the fun stuff like shadows and light and color. You can see her shadow popping on there, making this image overall darker, and then brightening up my subject. And all I'm doing here is trying to put the attention on my subject and take it away from these blank walls, because these blank walls are gorgeous. They're beautiful and they add a lot to the image, but in the end, that's not what I want the viewer to be looking at. I just want that to set the tone and location for the image. So we're getting to the final few steps here, where I tend to focus on color. You can see a vignette coming in, and I do all of this by hand. So if I'm doing a vignette, it's because I'm drawing it in wherever I want it to make it more believable. And then the final adjustment there. And that was how this image came together. It was a bit of a whim. I had not planned this image. I did something in the space, and I tried to use form and shape as the centerpiece of this picture. Now for a stark contrast, this image is what we're going to focus on next. It's called Catharsis, and this is a self-portrait just in my bedroom, really simple space. That's how I love to shoot, is just in my own comfortable white wall space. And that's what this was. I'll show you the before images. This was actually the stuffing that I used, this exact image of the pillowcase and the stuffing coming out of it. I ripped it open and I was able to use this little piece here as my skin. So I just blended that right into my skin. I made sure that the pillow was roughly the same color. And this is the image that I used to blend that stuffing right in, right up in here. So let's take a look at this image, before and after. And you'll see the before is quite the same as what I just showed you. Just a very, very blank space here. And it will get even more blank. I want to get rid of the curtains and get rid of anything in the background, because the back and the subject here has to be what we're focused on. So I got rid of the wall in the background and blended that. And then I started to make this area darker in the background. And you can see how it's not quite working yet. You can see this ghosting effect right through here, where it's whiter and brighter all around the subject. And that's because I'm manually darkening this image. And you could argue and say, well, why don't you just use lights? Well, because I don't like using lights, that's why. I don't have to use lights if I don't want to. And I think there is nothing wrong with a little bit of Photoshop. So I've really gotten into this method of lightening the subject and darkening the background, hopefully in a believable way, through a series of selections, feathering, and curves. So here we have the stuffing. And I added that right in, and immediately you can see that the color is off, that my skin was more pink and the pillow was a little bit more yellowish green. So that's something that needs to be refined, and these adjustment layers over here will do that. And we're just going in and making it pinker, making it match the skin a little bit better, adding in a little bit more stuffing, and just refining this image. So that now we're really putting all the emphasis on the subject. And that's what these steps will be, is more darkening, more color. Adding light, taking away light. Here's texture that I'm adding into this picture. This texture is a very important part of my process. It allows the image to feel more painterly, a little bit softer, a little bit more timeless. And then we just have two more steps, there we go, until it's finished. This is the next image, this image with the puddle. And I created this year. And this was a really interesting image for me because I had to really pay attention to color in this picture. The other ones, yes, of course they have color. And of course I think about color and it's very important to me. But in this image, not all was what it seems. So if we go down to the original image here, you can see that this was my frame just right here. And absolutely no red color in this dress. That was what I had to change. So I went in and I began to change what I wanted to change. First, I did my frame expansion where we have a little bit more puddle and a little bit more puddle until all of the frame was added in. And one little chunk there. So once that was added, I was able to start paying attention to the overall form. This is my frame as you see it right here. That is finished. So now we can focus on all of these difficult little changes, like adding in some drops, which I photographed right there at that puddle. I just threw some rocks in and photographed all these little droplets with the little splashes. And there. Now, this step is a very interesting step for me. It's something that I do quite frequently, which is to, not entirely, but somewhat desaturate my images. And I do that so that I can add another color over top, and that color, no matter what it is, sticks to the image overall in a more uniform way. For example, if I have a green tint in the upper right corner and a yellow tint in the lower left corner, and I have all these different colors, and then I try to add, let's say, a blue filter over it, the blue is going to apply differently to the yellow, to the red, to the orange, to the purple, all these different colors. So I tend to make those changes right up front. And here we go with this massive change right there. And what's happening here in this step, if I open up this curve box, is that you can see I'm changing a lot of things drastically in curves. In the blue curve, I am taking away blue and adding yellow. In the red curve, I'm taking away cyan and adding red. And then in the RGB curve, I'm actually making this entire dress much darker than it was. And that's giving me a more saturated red color than I would normally get. A few more adjustments all around the edges, refining the light, because so much of my process is about refining the light. Until our eye starts to focus in on the subject and the puddle. Because my images are very conceptual, so I don't want the viewer to look at any extraneous information. If there's something on the edge of the frame that might in any way distract from what I want the viewer to focus on, then I get rid of it. And I pay very close attention to be able to get rid of any distractions in my images. I like to think that what I'm doing in Photoshop is taking away anything that doesn't provide simplicity visually to the viewer, and making sure that that process allows the viewer to focus on the concept. A couple more stages. Here's the texture that I always add. And then adding a little bit more color and drama to this image. 3, 2, 1, until we finish. So those were three of my images that I have played with in Photoshop. And this is very indicative of my process. When I'm shooting, I really like to focus on concept. And once I know the idea or the theme behind my images, and I typically always go back to just one single word that I can boil the image down to, once I have that one word, then I start to put together the visual. So in the case of the image with the stuffing coming out of my back, the word was catharsis, which is also the title of the image. And I thought, how do I visually represent that one word? What does that feel like to me? And then how does that look? And that's what made me come up with the blue color scheme and the really desaturated color scheme, because that felt a little bit darker, a little bit sadder, a little bit more clinical. And then what is catharsis? It is the release of emotion or something else entirely. And I thought, what if the thing that I'm releasing is the stuffing, the thing that makes me me? And I went with a literal definition of stuffing by having stuffing coming out of my back. So I love to start with theme and then symbolism and then ask, how can I create that concept visually, and then how can I relate that to other people? So when I get into Photoshop, you can see that I'm not making anything digitally. It is all images that I have captured in that space that are being added in and layered to create this effect. Everything that I do is very much in the mindset of a painter, where you're doing one small tweak and then saying, now what can the image use to get closer to my goal? The way that I know that an image is finished is if it matches what I saw in my imagination when I thought of it. And I tend to go into a photo shoot with this, all these building blocks. And after I've put the building blocks together in my imagination, I have an idea of what it should look like, the color scheme, the composition, and everything that goes with that. So that once I'm editing and it starts to get really close to what I had in my mind, I know that I'm getting close to the finish line. I hope that this was enlightening in some way to see the process behind the work, and I hope that it inspires you to go out and shoot something and make it as close to your imagination as possible. We have this creative freedom that we can only dream of. And I think it is the most beautiful thing to be able to express ourselves with these simple tools that we have right in front of us. So thank you very much for watching. I hope that you'll subscribe and share this video with anyone who is interested in editing Photoshop photography or just some weird creative imaginative stuff. So thank you so much. Have a beautiful day. And as always, share with me what you create. Bye.